The pulmonary valve is typically made up of three leaflets, the anterior, the left, and the right, and it opens during systole to allow blood to be ejected to the lungs. During diastole, it closes to let the heart fill with blood and get ready for another systole. If the pulmonary valve doesn't open all the way, it gets harder to pump out to the lungs, and this is called pulmonary stenosis. If it doesn't close all the way, then blood leaks back into the right ventricle, and this is called pulmonary valve regurgitation, or pulmonary insufficiency. Pulmonary valve stenosis is often congenital, meaning that from birth the leaflets might not be fully developed, or irregularly shaped. Pulmonic valve stenosis is often associated with congenital heart conditions like tetralogy of Fallot, which affects all four chambers of the heart, as well as a genetic condition called Noonan syndrome. Other times there can be mechanical stress over time, which damages endothelial cells around the valves, and causes fibrosis and calcification, which hardens the valve and makes it more difficult to open all the way. Because it's kind of hard to open, when the right ventricle tries to eject blood, it resists for a split second and then finally snaps open, and this causes a characteristic ejection click. Also, since the blood has to flow through a narrow opening, there ends up being turbulence after, which creates a noise or a murmur, which gets louder as more blood flows past the opening, and then gets quieter as the amount of blood flowing subsides, because there's less in the ventricle. This sound is described as a crescendo-decrescendo murmur. Since it's harder to open and push blood past the hardened valve, the right ventricle has to generate really high pressures, and to achieve those pressures it thickens its muscles, called concentric right ventricular hypertrophy. This happens because new sarcomeres are added in parallel to the existing ones. Even though you have this bulked up ventricle, the heart still might struggle to get enough blood through the narrowed opening into the lungs. And ultimately, that means having blood get backed up, and so the person can develop right-sided heart failure. A final different complication is called microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, which is essentially damage to red blood cells as they're forced through the smaller valve, and this splits them into smaller fragments called schistocytes, which leads them to get peed out in the urine and leads to hemoglobinuria, or hemoglobin in the urine. As far as signs and symptoms go, when the blood gets backed up to the body, it can lead to distended neck veins, swelling of the ankles and feet, as well as hepatosplenomegaly, which is an enlarged liver and spleen. Since less blood's able to get into the lungs, it can also cause symptoms like cyanosis, which is blue or purple discoloration of the skin, as well as shortness of breath and fatigue, which are most notable when the body's demand for oxygen is high, like during exercise. Diagnosis is usually done with an echocardiogram, and treatment of pulmonic valve stenosis usually involves a balloon valvuloplasty, which means that a balloon is inserted and then inflated to open up the narrow valve, and ultimately allow more blood to flow through it. Alright, so that was pulmonary stenosis, but what about pulmonary regurgitation? With pulmonary regurgitation, the valve doesn't close all the way during diastole, or ventricular filling. So blood ends up flowing back from the pulmonary artery into the right ventricle. Regurgitation can happen due to valvular damage, from something like infective endocarditis, which is a bacterial infection of the inner lining of the heart. Another cause is rheumatic heart disease, where chronic inflammation leads to fibrosis, but instead of fusing the leaflets together, it makes it so that they don't form a nice seal and instead let blood leak back through. Sometimes pulmonic regurgitation can be caused by previous heart surgeries as well, like a balloon pulmonary valvuloplasty for pulmonary stenosis that opens the valve too far, or a malfunctioning prosthetic valve. In pulmonary regurgitation, since blood's leaking back from the pulmonary artery into the right ventricle, there's a diastolic decrescendo murmur. It's considered a decrescendo murmur because it starts out loudest and then becomes more quiet over time. The backflow of blood increases the right ventricular blood volume, and this therefore increases the amount of work that the right ventricle has to do during systole. So over time again, the right ventricle grows larger, a process this time called eccentric ventricular hypertrophy. In this situation, new sarcomeres are added in series to existing ones. This compensation works for a little while, but eventually the right ventricle might not be able to keep up, and this can again lead to right-sided heart failure. Initially, pulmonary valve regurgitation might cause no symptoms at all, but over time it can lead to right-sided heart failure, which can lead to blood backing up, and symptoms like distended neck veins, swelling of the ankles and feet, and hepatosplenomegaly. Diagnosis is usually again done with echocardiogram, and treatment for pulmonary regurgitation is usually valve replacement if right-sided heart failure develops. Alright, as a quick recap, pulmonary valve stenosis is associated with congenital heart conditions like tetralogy of Fallot, and it results in the pulmonary valve not opening fully, and causes a crescendo-decrescendo murmur. Over time, it can lead to right-sided heart failure and signs of cyanosis, but can be treated with balloon valvuloplasty. Pulmonary valve regurgitation is associated with things like infection and surgeries, and results in blood flowing backwards into the right ventricle, and it can cause a diastolic decrescendo murmur. It's usually asymptomatic, but over time it can lead to right-sided heart failure, and can be treated with valve replacement. What's happening, guys? Thanks for watching that video on pulmonic valve diseases. It was kind of another cardiovascular video, which I had thought we sort of finished all of those videos, but it looks like we forgot a couple stragglers. So be on the lookout for a couple more cardiovascular videos in the near future. And if you want to learn more about this particular one, you should for sure head over to osmosis.org. Osmosis.org is like our app platform. It's really awesome. Has a bunch of flashcards and quiz questions, but also like some really awesome scheduling tools that will help you through med school and just sort of organize your life. So if you're interested in that, I would really recommend heading over there and checking it out. Otherwise, you can always support us by donating on Patreon and subscribing to our channel and following us on social media. This video was written by Simone Taylor, and it was their first video script with Osmosis, so congrats. I think it was really awesome. It was edited by Rishi and Andrea. I did the video edit. No, I did the illustration and the voiceover. Yifan did the video editing. So thank you to everyone who worked on this video. I think it was really good. Till next time, see you later.